thank you very much, Alan. It's nice to visit what I always think of as the Dominion Observatory again, and I was reflecting a moment ago that it's 40 years since I first had the privilege of coming here, and Dr. Beals wanted fairly made it work to get started here, and Dr. Roy took that on and developed it. And so time goes by, and you know, perhaps you'll be kind enough to ask me here in 10 years' time to celebrate my 50th anniversary. Well, I thought that today I'd like to draw attention to a discovery which has recently been made by the Galileo team, Margaret Kimmelson from UCLA and other of her colleagues there, and David Southwood at Imperial College. And as I'll explain later in the talk, I think they've made a discovery which is not yet well known, because many people have not digested their work, but I think it has very important implications concerning early magnetic fields in the solar system, and that is the main purpose of my talk. But in thinking about the talk, I realized that this discovery of the apparent permanent magnetizations of the asteroids Ida and Gaspra just demonstrates that we are finding paramagnetism throughout the solar system. And I wanted to begin by a little bit of the history of paramagnetism, mainly to point out the great variety of techniques which have had to be used to investigate paleomagnetism. Of course, this is very familiar. I think perhaps I'll stand here, and if we can move this. Oh, no, it's fine.
Is that
the, or perhaps I'll stand here. The, this is, of course, a very familiar. It is from the first treatise on experimental physics by William Gilbert, physician to Queen Elizabeth. And it is important because Gilbert was a Copernican, as I'll explain tonight, but in this treatise he demonstrated the properties of magnets, that they have poles, and ended up by doing a model experiment that Sidney Chapman once called the only successful model experiment in the whole history of geophysics. of course, Gilbert showed that the angle of magnetic dip, the angle made by the direction of the Earth's field with the surface, was similar to that produced by a uniformly magnetized sphere. Now, of course, he was demonstrating the dipole character of a magnetized globe, and concluded that the Earth itself had a magnetic field which arose from within. A discovery, of course, which was given mathematical form two centuries later by Gauss, when he developed the special harmonic method of analyzing a field known over the surface into a part of internal and a part of external origin. And from the magnetic surveys of the globe that Gauss and Humboldt developed a mathematical proof of Gilbert's demonstration was made. This, of course, is an early magnetic map. The variation of the compass, of course, we call it the declination now, and this was the first map of the globe made by Halley. The next pair of slides. Well, Chapman, shown here, who was one of the leaders who developed the Geophysical Institute in Alaska that I'm going to, wrote the definitive work on geomagnetism in 1940 with Bartels, and I wanted to make the point that in Chapman's book of about well over 1,000 pages, there are only a few pages devoted to the explanation of the main field. The treatise is mainly about what we would now call solar-terrestrial relations, and there's a similar very short chapter of a few pages on paleomagnetism. Not very much was known in the 1940s, either about the origin of the main field of the Earth or about paleomagnetism. In fact, when I started my academic career at Manchester in 1946, only two bodies of the universe, the Earth and the Sun, were known to have magnetic field. Now, as I'll show, we know a great deal about magnetism in the solar system. The next pair of slides. Now, in that chapter of Chapman and Bartels, just a few pages on paleomagnetism, there is this diagram reproduced from a paper by Gelich, who was an applied geophysicist, who took a magnetometer across the great system of dikes in South Africa, the Landsberg dikes. And you'll see that the anomalies that he found were very large. And you'll also notice, of course, that the anomalies are positive, and of course that means that in the southern hemisphere they really are negatively magnetized. We would say that they were a very early example of remnant magnetization indicating a field reversed, more or less, to the present one. And although, as I said, very little was known about paleomagnetism at the time, Chapman, in this chapter, doesn't dismiss this evidence of a very different field from the present, but gives a very, shall I say, cautious interpretation of paleomagnetism. This is work, again, quite early in the 1940s, done by Brookshaw and Robertson. And whereas these dikes, of course, are Precambrian, The dikes that they studied are tertiary, and they took simple magnetometers across these dikes and showed that they were reversely magnetized. There is another great igneous body in Northumberland, the Wind Sill of Carboniferous Age, and two pioneers of the geophysical method in the British Geological Survey took magnetometers across the Wind Sill and found that it was horizontally magnetized with a direction pointing south. These were very early examples of paleomagnetic directions, which made no sense in terms of the present Earth's field. And the next pair of slides shows Brookshaw and Robertson's studies. Again, they, like Gellage, they had a simple magnetometer which they used, Schmidt balance, which they took across the dikes. And you'll see in this case, of course, that they get strong negative anomalies, and they interpret it in terms of directions of magnetization across each of these dikes. They found that on the whole the dikes were magnetized reversely compared with the present Earth's field. Now the next slide. Well, so the early measurements were done with magnetometers in the way that was used for surveys. And then, of course, when in the 1950s paleomagnetism really developed and the three discoveries were made, firstly, that the present magnetic field, when you can average the field over a period of some thousands of years, turns out to be a dipole along the present axis of rotation. And the second discovery, of course, of paleomagnetism was the discovery of reversals of this dipole. And the third discovery was that when you go back before tertiary times, you find directions which are different for different geological periods. And that, of course, was interpreted in terms of polar wandering and continental drift. And to illustrate the this method, which came into use in the 1950s, I show a slide that from Hospa's work on the paleomagnetism of lava flows from Iceland. And of course this is a stereographic projection, and the black dots are directions of magnetization of lava flows, in which the north seeking pole points downwards, as the magnetic field does in Iceland, and the open circles show the reverse magnetizations, in which the north seeking pole points to the south with a negative angle of magnetic dip. And these pioneering results of Hospa's, we argued, did really imply reversals of the Earth's field. and it was important to find a statistical method, which was supplied by R.A. Fisher, to look at the mean direction shown by the two stars, and the means, of course, of the normal group and the reverse group turn out to be about 180 degrees apart. And when these measurements were extended to geological periods before the tertiary, one began to find another phenomena in addition to the reversals coming in, and that of course is that the mean of this group and the mean of that group, the open circles, are negative angles of dip, black dots, positive angles of dip, that the azimuth becomes markedly different from the present meridian. These are tertiary, Triassic rocks, red sandstones from Wyoming, and the angle of dip shown here about 20 degrees that corresponds of course to about 10 degrees of latitude, and it became clear that Europe and North America were much nearer the equator for the late Paleozoic and Mesozoic. The next pair of slides. I wanted to remark that one of the difficulties in the early development of paleomagnetism was that, and I shall refer to it a little bit later in connection with meteorites, that secondary magnetizations can be acquired from the present Earth's magnetic field, but these secondary magnetizations were very early recognized as biasing the early original direction of the Earth's field, and I select two slides here which show this phenomena rather strikingly. These are from Precambrian rocks, the Shinumu quartzite in the Grand Canyon, and we know that the original direction of the Earth's field is like that. The present field is indicated by the square, and these rocks have been magnetized to different extents by sitting for the last 700,000 years in the present Earth's field. And another example is the Springdale sandstone of Triassic times from Zion National Park, which are again strung along the Great Circle. The original Triassic direction, as you saw on this screen, is somewhere up there. Some of the samples have acquired magnetization along the present field. And in fact, it's rather interesting that when this method of either taking hand samples and drilling them in order to make measurements of the magnetization, or when the technique of drilling at the outcrop was used, when that method was applied to the Palandsberg dikes, which I was talking about a moment ago, it was found by Goff and the other early workers that the directions of magnetization were quite random, and it caused some a problem at first, until they realized that in sampling from outcrops of the Plansburg dikes in South Africa, in a country much prone to lightning, they were looking at magnetization by lightning strikes. I shall come back to that in a moment. Now the next slide. Well, from the early paleomagnetic data, evidence was found, of course, for the migration of coal around the North Pacific. This is from an early example of the results from Britain, and this is an early example from rocks from North America, which I was just referring to. And the discrepancy between the polar wandering paths for the different continents, having got a very different polar wandering path from Australia, proved to be the first quantitative geophysical evidence for Wagner's continental drift. To this day, we have never succeeded really in disentangling two phenomena, one the relative movement of the continents, and another the phenomena of polar wandering. But as I'll say in a moment, that phenomena is rather beautifully demonstrated by the paleomagnetism of the moon. And this is a sketch, of course, of the succession of reversals of magnetization as it stood in the 1970s. It's become, of course, more complicated. We are particularly interested at the moment, those of us who are thinking about how the field reverses, by an event up there, the Blake reversal, about 120 million years ago. But this diagram kind of neatly shows how paleomagnetism can be studied on the Earth, either as Cox and Owe did, by dated magnetization directions from lavas, or by Updike's first demonstration that a similar record of reversals of magnetization is to be found in the ocean bottom cores, which have the advantage, of course, over continental rocks of having been laid down reasonably uniformly so that you can recover the whole record. And then, of course, Ryan and Matthew's interpretation of the ocean magnetic surveys in terms of successive magnetizations of additions to the ocean floor erupted from mid-ocean ridges. So what is seeing here in the development of paleomagnetism, the use of very different techniques to obtain information about the magnetization of rocks and the history of the field. The next slide. Now, I've spoken here about the results of lunar paleomagnetism, and I only want to very quickly remind you of the main discoveries. Already in 1960, 1969, the Russians had sent two spacecraft, Luna 1 and Luna 2, with magnetometers in, and Luna 3, which took the first photograph of the far side of the moon. And the magnetometers measured, one didn't hit the moon, but they both recorded no magnetic field of the moon. And in the climate of opinion about the moon at the time, when it was becoming clear as a result of the work of Baldwin and Urey and others that the craters on the moon were impact, and that according to Urey and Gould, the moon had formed as a cold accreted body and had not differentiated. Then, of course, it was not thought that there was any chance that the moon could have an iron core and generate a field. But, and so the magnetization found in the returned lunar samples by our group and by a number of others, including Dave Strangway's group and Mike Fuller's, the remnant magnetization of the moon rocks raised very fundamental questions about the origin of the magnetizing field. It's forgotten now, but the magnetometers, this is the Apollo 15 site, the magnetometers which were landed on the moon, and those used in the short traverses also revealed that there was local magnetization in the moon rocks. The next slide. Well, I'm only just say one or two summarizing sentences about lunar paleomagnetism. The problem with the interpretation of lunar paleomagnetism was the return samples were not oriented, which forced lunar paleomagnetism along a different development to terrestrial paleomagnetism, and so a lot of work was done on determining the paleointensity, that is the strength of the field responsible for the magnetization. And this is a summary slide. We know now the reason why these Apollo 15 and Apollo 11 samples gave rather low paleointensities, and there is now general agreement in the rather small paleomagnetic community that the moon's magnetic field, or at any rate the magnetizing field present when the lavas and breccias cooled, was very high around this time, 3.9 billion years ago. It was about one gauss, almost twice the present Earth's field. It declined exponentially to about a 50th of the value around this time. And then sometime later, we believe the dynamo responsible for this field turned itself off. Very recently, Fuller and Sosowski had developed another method of determining paleo intensity besides the traditional ones shown here, which are the Tellier and Stevenson method. And these dots, with no error bars, are the estimates of the field. The reason there are no error bars is that they are estimates, but they can be obtained from a lot of lunar rocks, and they broadly agree with the high field found by the more experimental methods, and the decline of this field to about a 50th of a Gauss at this time. But these rather numerous values bring out a point which has really escaped us until very recently, and that is that there appears to be a rapid rise in the field just prior to reaching the maximum value. And this again has provided some new evidence, and my interpretation of it, for what it's worth, and I mention it because it's quite new, is that the core, the iron core of the moon, formed rather late. And the reason physically that that is reasonable is that in the case of an accreted body like the Earth, the formation of its core releases a huge amount of gravitational potential energy sufficient to heat the Earth twice over, and sufficient to melt the Earth twice over, whereas in a smaller body like the Moon, it is possible that the core could form late because the amount of energy released is quite small. And so this is a new constraint on the origin of the moon, because according to this argument, the moon starts cold, it is heated up gradually by uranium-235, solid-state creep produces, solid-state creep allows convection and the core forms, but only at this point does the dynamo start. The difficulty that presented itself in the development of lunar paleomagnetism, as I've just been explaining, is the absence of directions, directional data on the ancient field. But this has been obtained because the UCLA group had a magnetometer in the sub-satellites launched in the Apollo 15 and 16 mission. They picked up, as you see, three component anomalies, and particularly Russell, Coleman, and Hood interpreted those anomalies as, of course, being due to magnetized strata at the surface, and Hood in particular gave directions of these magnetized strata. And I've interpreted them in terms of the hypothesis that the moon had an early magnetic field generated, as I have been explaining, by dynamo action in the core, and that that field was a dipole aligned along the axis of rotation. And this work has gone forward now and produced evidence for polar wandering on the moon and evidence for early satellites of the moon. And I'll just very quickly show a couple of slides. The next slide. Now, the problem with interpreting the paleomagnetism of the moon is we have numerous directions of magnetization of strata, but unlike a paleomagnetic study on the Earth, we do not know the age, and that is a rather long story, but I show here that there are three ages for which we have magnetic directions and pole positions. This is very old, pre-Nectarian, 4.1 billion years. This is the present north, and the north poles are arranged in a dipolar arrangement, defining an axis shown by the stars, 95% circles of confidence, demonstrating that the moon has rotated through 90 degrees with respect to its axis of rotation in space, what the geologists always used to call polar wandering. And of course the paleo equator is at right angles to the present equator, and the very old pre-Nectarian basins determined by the geologists, particularly Don Wilhelms, are shown here. These are the sites of the magnetic anomalies, and you see a strong tendency for the impact basins to be in low latitude at that time, 4.1 billion years ago. The next pair of slides show the two other periods or for which we have data. This is the lower Nectarian, 4 billion years. And now this is a stereographic projection with this is the present axis of the Earth, and the black dots here and on that diagram are north magnetic poles on the southern hemisphere of the moon. The open circles are north magnetic poles on the northern hemisphere. And so you see by these stars, which are means, you see two other axes are found from the paleomagnetic data for 4 billion years and 3.85 billion. The points, the number of pole positions is relatively small, which of course makes the terrestrial paleomagnetist skeptical, but one has to remember that satellite surveys give you, for each determination of the anomaly, the mean of quite a large area of strata. So I think these data are to be taken quite seriously. This, you see, is another way of determining the remnant magnetization from kind of satellite surveys. And if the geology of the Earth had been simpler, and if there was no magnetic field on the Earth, which of course gives a magnetization along the present field to every strata, an induced magnetization, I'm quite certain that we would use some kind of airborne or satellite magnetic survey to do the job which the terrestrial paleomagnetism does by the laborious method of drilling cores. The next slide. Well, the paleomagnetism of the Moon is summarized in this diagram, and this shows the evidence that the Moon had a satellite system, because as you saw in the case of the oldest pole corresponding to this paleo-equator, there is a strong tendency for impact basins, the multi-ring basins, to be in low latitude at the time of their formation. And you see it, of course, perhaps most strikingly for the youngest of the pole positions, which we were looking at a moment ago. The pole is here, and the equator is here, that Oriental, Hertzsprung, Schrödinger, Christian, Serenitatis, and Imbrium are the impact basins, the multi-ring basins, formed around 3.85 billion years, and they were formed in low latitude. It's also true of the 4 billion year basins, and for that reason we concluded that lunar paleomagnetism shows that the Moon had a satellite system, at least three satellites, the orbits of which decay, and you can show, I don't want to say more, you can show that the requirements of Euler's principle that the body will always rotate about its axis of maximum moment of inertia, and if you disturb that, the distribution of mass by creating basins, the Clementine mission has shown that the basins on the far side are associated with negative gravity anomalies. The ones on the near side, of course, were flooded with lava much later than their creation as impact basins. But anyway, the summary statement about lunar paleomagnetism is that the pole positions calculated by the paleomagnetic method, here are the three pole positions, are in agreement with what Euler's principle of the rotation of solid bodies, modified of course by the idea that movements of mass are involved in the large basins and slightly upset the axis of maximum moment of inertia and cause the polar wandering. The next slide. Well, just pass over this slide, please. Now, another method which has revealed, another technique which has revealed paleomagnetism in the solar system, is due to Dr. Sonnet and his team, who had a magnetometer in the Explorer 35 satellite around the moon, and the conclusion that they reached from their studies of the solar wind was that there were a large number of local magnetic fields arising, of course, from the remnant magnetization of the rocks on the moon that I've been talking about. And this work was done very soon after the first discovery of remnant magnetization, and of course helped to convince people that the rocks returned to the Earth had really been magnetized on the moon and have not been inadvertently magnetized in the NASA laboratory in Houston. Well, I'll refer again to the method that Sonnet used to deduce this, these local magnetic fields. But as I explained, in the time when the first results from the Apollo missions were being obtained on magnetization, there was skepticism that the moon could have once had a dynamo magnetic field, and that resulted in questions being raised as to whether there were any local mechanisms of magnetization present on the moon, such as the lightning strokes, which, as I explained, were observed in the early development of terrestrial paleomagnetism, and until it was realized what was being looked at, was a bit of a nuisance. And von Ehrenhide, in this paper, or this abstract, said was that the greatest release of energy occurring on the moon is impacts. The shockwave which rocks on the moon will experience probably facilitates magnetization. The rock lavas on the Earth and the lavas and breccias on the moon, of course, are magnetized as they cool just below the Curie point, when the physical state of the domains facilitates the picking up of magnetization from an ambient field. So I think, although we don't know even now very much about impact magnetization, it undoubtedly is a process which can facilitate the process of picking up magnetization from an ambient field. But Hyde goes further here and suggests that the swirling plasma around an impact site might act itself as a little dynamo and magnify the solar wind magnetic field, which of the moon is about 20 gamma, and gamma is 10 to the minus 5 Gauss, 10 to the minus 9 Tesla. And so this idea that material in the solar system can be magnetized by impact without there being a field present from the planet this idea has been around for quite a long time and is really very difficult to test, and therefore, of course, it's not, in to my view, a very good theory. The next slide. But it is interesting that we have one clear case of magnetization being acquired, or actually increased, as a result of impact. Now, the electron scatter method has revealed paleomagnetism of the moon, and what this experiment was the Berkeley group had a method of looking at the electrons in the solar wind, and they were all surprised to find that some of the electrons came back from the lunar surface, reflected from the lunar surface. And so here is another technique which reveals paleomagnetism, and the work of Kinsey Anderson and his colleagues produces a nice map of remnant magnetization, or rather, of course, the surface magnetic fields arising from remnant magnetization of the moon. But for the purposes that I've been describing, the fact that you don't know the direction, but only the intensity of the field, is a handicap. But these red areas are the strong magnetizations, and it is found that they are antipodal to the impact basins, the last great impact basins that I was just discussing, Imbrium, Crisium, Serenitatis, Oriental, Humorum. And so here is a case where there seems to be a good correlation between impact and strong magnetization, but the cause and the effect are 180 degrees apart. The next pair of slides. And the magnetizations you're looking at are antipodal to these last great impact basins, Crisium, Serenitatis, Imbrium, Humorum, and Nectaris. Explanation that I favour is simply that these great impacts produce shock waves which are focused at the antipodal point, and they of course heat the rocks up at the antipodal point. Heating silicates in a vacuum results in the precipitation of iron grains, and those iron grains become magnetized by the process we know of in paleomagnetism as the chemical remnant magnetization. There are regions on the moon, the so-called swirls, which have been held to be impact in origin, but they are associated with strong magnetic fields, and my interpretation of this is that here are regions where strong magnetic anomaly underneath Oceanus Procellarum is keeping the solar wind particles away. The next slide. pass over this next slide. And, well now, I want now to just explain the discovery, which I think is so important. This diagram, of course, show that most of the meteorites, apart from those that appear to be igneous rocks, dislodged from Mars by impacts. Meteorites were formed in the very early history of the solar system. And it's been known for a very long time that meteorites have remnant magnetization. All the problems that I've already referred to of secondary magnetization make the story quite complicated. But the conclusion that has been reached by all the various people who've worked on meteorite magnetization is the meteorites are magnetized by very early solar system magnetic fields. The next slide. But, go ahead, please. The link that has been established, of course, between meteorites and asteroids is very important, and this indicates one rather striking piece of the evidence that meteorites originally were part of bodies in the asteroid belt. The next slide. Now, the Galileo mission, which of course is going to study in some considerable detail the magnetic field of Jupiter by the orbiting method, it took this photograph of the moon, a rather nice one, and it photographed two asteroids, Ida and Gaspra, shown about the correct relative size. They're S-type asteroids, related probably to the meteorites known as ordinary chondrites, mainly silicates, but with quite a lot of iron grains. Now the next slide shows that the solar wind interacts in different ways with the bodies in the solar system, and a body such as the Earth or Jupiter or Mercury, which has a magnetic field, stops the solar wind. The solar wind, of course, compresses the magnetic field behind the magnetopores, and you can calculate, and this is rather important in the discussion of the interaction between the asteroids and the solar wind, you can calculate the from the standoff position the strength of the Mercury magnetic field. And the Mariner 10 spacecraft passed Mercury on two occasions, and one can see the sort of, this is of course three component magnetometer, and you can pick out of course the various surfaces, the bow shock and the magnetic force. The next slide. Well, the magnetic field that was being recorded by the magnetometer of the Galileo mission as it passed Gaspra at about 1600 kilometres away is shown here. The three-component magnetometer, of course, gives you a magnetic field, about 20 gamma, and you're looking at the projection on the surface, which includes the path of the spacecraft in the direction to the sun, and you see that in this interval of time the magnetic field rotates towards Gaspra and then returns to more or less its original direction. And Mother Pilsen and her team picked this up and concluded that they were looking at a magnetohydraulic wave from Gaspra. The records, of course, show considerable noise, and the solar wind, of course, is continually changing, so that when they picked this up, had they only had one example of a magnetohydraulic interaction with a satellite, with an asteroid, one might have, dismissed this as an accident. But Ida too produces a magnetohydraulic wave. The next slide. Now, I think it's important to look for a moment at this diagram. This shows diagrammatically the different interactions of the solar wind with a planet with a strong magnetic field like the Earth, and with a planet like Mars, which has an atmosphere and an ionosphere. Now, in the case of a body without a present magnetic field like the Moon, all that happens is that the solar wind particles hit the Moon. They combine to form mainly hydrogen, which is held in the lunar soil and, of course, is provides very important information about the composition of the solar wind. But you don't see at a great distance away a magnetohydraulic wave. Of course, you see a region of zero solar wind, and it was, of course, within that shadow that Sonnet's Explorer 35 magnetometer picked up magnetic disturbances and caused Sonnet to conclude that the disturbance that they were looking at represented solar wind particles which were deflected at the limb of the Moon into this region which should be in complete shadow. And it was from those measurements that Solnit drew that diagram showing the local magnetic fields on the surface of the moon. And so the conclusion of the Galileo group is that if these bodies, Gaspra and Ida, were without magnetic fields, you would not see the magnetohydraulic wave that they detected. And so they argue that around Gaspra and Ida there is a region of magnetic field originating from the remnant magnetization of the asteroid. Now, in view of Hyde's hypothesis, it's natural to ask whether these asteroids, which obviously have undergone bombardment by small bodies, might have been magnetized by the process of impact magnetization that he put forward. But in order that the object is surrounded by a magnetic field to a considerable distance, a few times its physical size, several times its physical size, the body has to be uniformly magnetized. And my difficulty in accepting Hyde's proposal is that I can see that impact magnetization can produce local magnetizations, but I find it difficult to see that it can produce the uniform magnetization that is evidently required to explain their results. Now, Ida and a small satellite which was observed to orbit it are of course thought to be like other asteroids and meteorites, originally in a parent body. And in view of what I've been saying about the moon, that a small core, in the case of the moon probably 600 kilometers in radius, can produce a very strong magnetic field, as it did 3.9 billion years ago, when presumably the heat energy within the moon was quite intense. It dropped off later, and that is why the moon lost its magnetization, its early magnetic field. It's natural in approaching the problem of explaining the magnetization of Gaspra and Ida to think, well, in the parent body, probably heated by aluminium 26 in the first million years or so, a core of iron forms, which is molten and which is perhaps kept warm by iron 60, evidence for which also exists from meteorites in the early solar system. It's natural to think, well, perhaps Ida and Gaspra in the mantles of a parent body, as they cooled down, were magnetized by a dynamo field generated in the liquid iron core of the parent body. Well, that is a natural supposition, a natural theory, but when one looks into it, you find that it's extraordinarily difficult to construct a thermal history of a small parent body, perhaps just a few hundred kilometers in radius, it's very difficult to construct a thermal history which will allow the core to remain molten and vigorously convecting to produce a magnetic field, and a mantle which cools down, because you have to have an appreciable part of the mantle cooling to through the curie point of iron, about 780 degrees centigrade to ordinary temperatures. I'm convinced that it's impossible to produce such a thermal history. And so one is forced back to an idea which has been put forward from time to time in connection with the magnetization of meteorites, that appeals to the magnetic field of the early solar nebula, which was first suggested as a possible explanation for the distribution of angular momentum in the solar system. And in such a solar nebula magnetic field, any body which is originally hot, as a parent body would be, cooling down, spinning of course, so that the component of the solar nebula magnetic field along the axis of rotation is the magnetizing field. Such a magnetic field seems to me to be the likely cause of the magnetization of the asteroids and probably of the meteorites. I end by just remarking that in the vast literature of the magnetization of meteorites, I think the next slide shows, this of course shows Ida and Dactyl, and this shows the similar rotation of the direction of the solar wind near as the Kelvin spacecraft goes close to Ida. Now the next slide, this shows the encounter with Ida, or the flyby, at of course a very considerable distance, and it is this that is the observed magnetohydromic wave. The next slide, the data on meteorite magnetization is, as I've said, extraordinarily voluminous, but fairly good paleointensity measurements have been done on some meteorites, and there is agreement that the field responsible for the magnetization of meteorites is a few Gauss to perhaps a few tens of Gauss. And all those who've tried to calculate the strength of the early solar nebula magnetic field so that it is of such magnitude likely to be important in the redistribution of angular momentum, find this magnitude of magnetic field. And so I conclude by saying that it seems to me that the work of the Galileo Magnetometer team in picking up these maybe to hydrodynamic disturbances from Gaspra and Ida, have put in a new context the work done on the magnetization of meteorites, and have probably provided the best proof so far of the long proposed magnetic field in the early solar nebula, and illustrate a new method of detecting the very varied paleomagnetic data from the solar system. Thank you.
Any questions for Professor Runcorn? I just want to make a comment that wasn't Sir Harold Jeffreys, one of his complaints about paleomagnetism was that when you bang the rocks,
yes,
it will off you.
I was thinking about that page of Harold Jeffreys, the Earth, and I have actually a slide of it. Yeah, I think many people have been aware that stress and of various kinds can render paramagnetic materials capable of picking up remnant magnetization from an ambient field. And as I was explaining, I think possibly the most striking example of it is the antipodal relationship between the great final impact basins and the regions on the moon which show strong remnant magnetization. The new idea that Hyde introduced is you don't need an ambient field from any other origin except from the swirling plasma resulting from the impact itself. And various people have tried to demonstrate the possibility of this kind of impact magnetization. Mike Fuller and his group have fired shaped charges at a piece of rock, and Giovanni, an Italian, has done the same thing. But these experiments are difficult to perform, and the consensus about such experiments is that no one has succeeded in demonstrating that the magnetization picked up in such experiments was not due to the Earth's magnetic field. Attempts were made to compensate for the Earth's field, but they were never very successful. And so I think even the advocates of impact magnetization would say that there's no demonstration in the laboratory that such processes can work. And a lot of people are inclined to think that if impact is important in the solar system, it probably is that impact demagnetizes rocks. But as I said, that idea, and the Hyde continues to put it forward, that idea is very hard to test, whereas, of course, as I tried to point out in connection with the moon, the idea that the magnetization of rocks on the moon results from a dynamo within the moon, you know, can be tested because we have information particularly about the direction of the ancient magnetic field of the moon, from which pole positions can be determined, and then you can see if you can put together a self-consistent story of the wandering. But I don't know of any way that you could prove or could exclude the possibility that a small piece of rock returned from some planet was not magnetized by this hypothetical process.
Tonight, Dave, you have a question.
Yeah, getting back to the exponentially decreasing value of the paleo intensity
of the moon. Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know if this is physically possible or not, but just as to explore this possibility, I guess it's well known that the radius of the moon's orbit has been increasing over time.
Yeah.
And in the early history of the moon, would it ever have been close enough to the Earth for the Earth's magnetic field to have...
We did, of course, in the early days of the development of lunar paleomagnetism, take that quite seriously. There's quite a lot of mystery, of course, about the position of the moon in the early history of the Earth, because if you take the present parameters of tidal friction and assume that you can extrapolate back the moon's orbit using those parameters, you get into a nonsensical situation that the Earth and Moon were very close together a billion years ago rather than 4.5 billion years. And of course, people say, well, perhaps the tidal friction today and for a good part of Phanerozoic times, because we have got some evidence from growth rings on fossils that the moon has been retreating at more or less the same rate since the beginning of Phanerozoic time. People do say, well, perhaps in the Precambrian the tidal friction was much smaller than today. But it's very difficult to do any quantitative calculations. And the chief objection to the idea that the Earth magnetized the moon rocks is that you have, of course, from the satellite magnetic surveys that I was describing, you have paleomagnetic directions. And if, for example, the Earth magnetized rocks of a certain age on the moon, the directions of magnetization should not be dipole directions, but should be more or less parallel. And I did show a slide, but passed over it quickly, which was intended to meet exactly this question. And I might just very quickly say what it was. You can show that if a shell, the outer surface of the moon had been magnetized by a uniform field from outside, like that. And then, of course, that field goes away. And such a moon would have quite a considerable present dipole field. And the two slides, they were blue with white lines of force like that. The point of that slide was to show that if the moon had been magnetized by an internal magnetic field, of dipole configuration, then of course the outer part which got magnetized would be magnetized like that. And then what I showed in 1975 when this question came up was that after the dipole, after the dynamo ceased generating this field and the crust of the moon was magnetized like that, you can show that it produces no external magnetic field. It's an interesting, you know, little exercise in potential theory. Now, at that time, the satellites had been put around the moon with magnetometers in, and the first calculation which the UCLA group did was to calculate the present external magnetic field of the moon, the present dipole moment, and they found that it was so low that they cast doubt on whether the moon rocks were magnetized at all. And I produced this paper to argue that, in fact, because they found that the dipole field of the moon was at present zero, this rather argued in favor of this model rather than that model. Of course, that little exercise in potential theory is rather simplistic because, of course, the moon rocks are not, the moon is not a magnetized shell. No, I think this matter that you raise is interesting because, of course, people wondered whether the sun might have had a very strong magnetic field in its early history which could magnetize.
Well, I'd like to thank Professor Runcorn for a very interesting, wide-ranging talk, and I just wanted to say that this is approximately like your 40th anniversary.
Oh.
And you mentioned the golden anniversary coming up, but I was just going to say Professor Runcorn's mom recently celebrated her 100th birthday, so with good genetic background like that, we'll certainly look forward to many more talks. Thank you very much.